sometimes you have an experience that takes a long time for you to fully process. This has definitely been true for my first experience of solo travelling in 2018, and particularly for a trek I did in April 2018 with my friend Jordan through the Gaurishankar conservation area of Nepal. In 2015, Nepal was hit by a devastating earthquake. The destination for our trek was Gyalbashing in the Bigu region, which was one of the places worst hit, and 90% of the buildings there were completely destroyed. This isn't an area that tourists usually go, and there are currently no organised trekking tours or routes through this area. This all started with a conversation on the couchsurfing website with my now friend Rakshit about a dream he has to promote the Bigu area and to bring responsible tourism to the area to help support the people there as they continue to rebuild. I reached out to him whilst trying to make contacts a couple of months before I left for Nepal, and he said he was looking for a filmmaker to capture footage of a trek they were planning. He said to me that if I was up for it, he promises me an awesome experience. This is the story of what happened.
How are you feeling?
I'm feeling kind of drowsy, kind of panic, kind of comprehensive.
Man, I was hugging the toilet seat for 15 minutes and I'm so gonna miss it.
Enjoy!
We had an 150-kilometre drive east across the country to Kuri village on the edge of the conservation area. We set off just as the sun was coming up and left Kathmandu. The drive itself was amazing, and it was my first real experience getting out of the city to see the beautiful Nepal landscape. What just happened?
Our vehicle gave in to the terrain of the geography and we are stranded here right now.
Although we were fairly behind our initial schedule, we made decent progress and arrived in Kuri village just as the sun was setting. Straight away we got our first taste of rural Nepali culture, having snacks and a drink called tongba in a local's home, followed by some music and dancing. We tried to get a pretty early night though to wake up for the first climb of the trek.
So we're currently on day one of actual trekking. We're just climbing up to 3,800 meters for supposedly for sunrise, but we're too late, so we'll get just after sunrise. But Jordan's here with me.
Hi.
He's feeling really good. This is day one of six or seven, and I guess we'll see how it goes.
The first climb was steep and tough, especially after a freezing cold night with very little sleep. We were rewarded, though, with incredible views of the Himalayas in all directions, and Kalinchoke Temple, an amazing Hindu shrine at the top of the mountain.
I think we've got about 4 to 5 hours of trekking to do now. I'm carrying far too much stuff because I've got all my camera gear and my laptop and everything in my trekking bag, as well as two tripods. On with the trek. How are you feeling, Jordan?
Better than I was this morning. I woke up this morning absolutely freezing in my bed, and I was thinking, oh my God, this is like survival mode. Then we started walking up the hill. We got to the summit and then I felt good because you could see the Himalayas, which are just there.
It feels so nice to be out here. I have never experienced anything quite like these mountains in the Himalayas. It's just on another level. And last night we had a bit of a crazy first night. Got into this village and doesn't really have any proper power or anything, so I couldn't charge anything. So I'm gonna have to be quite conservative with what I use today.
We were loving the scenery, but we ended up getting very delayed, as a couple of our group stayed behind at Kuri village to try and charge camera and drone batteries, which we couldn't do the previous night due to inconsistent power. This meant that over 4 hours into the 5 hour trek, we weren't even close to halfway there. The others eventually caught up with us though, with good news saying that they managed to charge everything.
Hero! He's the drone hero!
So we carried on walking, but the beautiful weather from the morning started to shift shortly after we finished lunch, and the clouds started to roll in.
Which way? This way, though?
Wow, look at the beautiful view. Oh, the Himalayas.
We ended up getting to a fork in the road and had two choices. Either cross a very dangerous landslide caused by the earthquake in 2015, or take a really tough route up and over the mountain.
Let's go through landslide.
No way.
You feeling good?
That's yeah. The only way.
No way.
That's the only way.
Go and see the ones.
That's the way that
we have. This is an interesting moment. We've just hit in the trek, where we're delayed by several hours, and the fog has just rolled in massively, so I'm just trying to make our way through it. Hopefully not die or get lost, or both. So I think we've got to the point now where, because most of the routes are sort of unsafe or undoable, the only option is now to climb up there. And I think it's about 2 hours till it gets dark, so... yeah. Pretty much made it up that bit that you saw before, and we're finally back on the right track again. How are you finding it, Jordan?
Smashing it.
We're stranded, guys! Where to go?
We're stranded in 36,000 meters.
And there's a thunderstorm over
there. Yeah, right there. I've had this fear before. It's a reoccurring fear.
Unfortunately, we weren't on the path that we thought we were on, and we had no idea what direction to go in. The weather also started to get much worse. It eventually started to get dark, and visibility continued to deteriorate. By the time it got to 8 p.m, we'd been on the mountain for over 13 hours, and we could barely see anything. So we had no choice but to try and quickly form a makeshift shelter at 3,500 meters. In the middle of the night, a big thunderstorm and snowstorm hit.
So it's now the morning after the last clip you will have seen. Basically what happened last night is the visibility got so bad that we realised we'd been going in the wrong direction and we couldn't see basically 2 metres in front of us. So we decided we just had to make camp. But the problem is we didn't have any tents or sleeping bags. At about midnight or 11:30, a big thunderstorm came in and it started chucking it down with hails and snow, and we were all like huddled in this little makeshift shelter trying to keep warm. Basically none of us got any sleep.
Yo!
All of our stuff's in good condition.
That could have been us.
How are you feeling?
Elated. just what an experience that was. 5 hours ago, I was feeling like, am I going to live? And then now everyone's alive, so it's good. Everyone's happy. And we're just getting organised and getting away.
It was an incredible atmosphere in the morning when the sun came up. There were several people in our group that were genuinely fearing for their lives when the storm got to the worst point the night before. But before finishing packing to start to trek down the mountain, we checked out the views and took in the sunrise.
Extra element.
Oh my goodness!
Okay.
Fuck!
No way, Jose!
Oh fuck!
No way!
Let's walk into the garden.
Right, we pretty much got out of all the snow and near-death experience zone. How are you finding it, John?
Good, mate.
All right, cool. Well, we should be about...
Really high.
We should be about 15 minutes away.
All right.
But we're probably more like 5 hours away.
I thought you meant altitude.
But I am ready for food. So we finally arrived for lunch about 7 hours after we left on the 2 hour trek to lunch. I think I've worked out on average it's usually between 4 and 15 times longer than they say it's going to be to get somewhere. So that's good to know, I guess. At least it's still nice scenery.
We were now deep in the heart of rural Nepal and were instantly greeted by some locals who cooked us amazing food, gave us some local alcohol, and helped us organise transport for the last portion of the trip to Gyalbashing village.
This is it, Polly.
Ani? Kero shows I can move him here, or maybe you can come here.
By the time we arrived at the village, it was already dark, but we were greeted at Rakshit's family home with beds and blankets, which felt amazing. We spent the next day just relaxing in Gyalbashing village, taking in the local life and beautiful surroundings. We visited a local school and we saw how everybody there worked. It really blew us away how hospitable and welcoming everyone was that we met. Every house we turned up to invited us in to give us homemade drinks and snacks, and everyone was just so incredibly positive.
Thank you.
Like, my soul is coming out of my ears.
Trust me, it's a lot of fun. I wish somebody could.
So glad I just got that. Like, my soul's coming out my ears.
Like, my soul's leaving my ears.
Everybody is having rum and honey.
What are you cooking?
Chicken roast, and then there is a chicken curry with that. And rice will be there. Mm. Apart from that, there is a egg curry with soya meat, with provolone. Mm. And some salads.
In the evening, we lit a fire, made some drinks, food, and we just reminisced on the night before, having a good laugh and just enjoying the feeling of being able to fully relax.
I came inside and I heard a fart let out. I'm like, okay. A thousand days and the sun won't shine before I come back to you. She's the showstopper.
But it has been about sensitivity throughout. And
it was about numbness
and adaptability.
Comfortably.
Let's play that game.
Uncomfortably numb.
Numb.
I'm happy. Nothing's going to stop me. I'm making my way.
No matter how much I love you.
Can I not?
No matter how much I love you, baby.
Listen, come here.
It was time to get back on with actual trekking, and we wanted to visit a mountain that we would have climbed had we not got lost on the second day. We packed up and set off for a two-day trek, having regained some energy. We passed several areas where the earthquake had definitely left its mark in the form of huge landslides. So we're now on to day 5 of the trek. We were meant to leave at about 8 o'clock this morning and we ended up leaving at about 10, as usual. Say the name of this place.
Do Gyurmu.
So we're now going past Do Gyurmu. It's a little sort of cattle farm, I guess, isn't it? And we're heading up to a campsite, which is halfway up a mountain that we're climbing tomorrow. Very beautiful up here. The hospitality of the Nepali people continued to amaze me. Although we turned up completely unannounced, the local farmers here invited us in and let us cook in their home and rest for a couple of hours. I'd love to return to this area with more time to spend with these people to talk to them and get to know their story.
So we've climbed a long way. We started all the way down there. Hopefully not too long now till the campsite. We can just chill out.
We got to the camping spot in good time in the end, and we set up our tents outside another shelter where a yak herding family lived, halfway up the mountain we were climbing. We lit a big fire and hung out with the family for a bit before going to sleep.
Right, it's the morning after camping. This is like the last climb before we head back down and go back to Kathmandu. I'm in so much pain and knackered.
I'm feeling fine. Dave's just complaining like a little bitch.
Not really. I'm in quite a lot of pain. I'm glad we've done this because...
Pretty beautiful scenery.
It's been... Like, when else are you going to be able to wake up in a place like this? And also, like, these experiences will stay with us forever. Apart from the fact it's been sort of shambolic at times. Yeah, it's been like this. It's been like really good highs and then really sort of horrible lows. And then, but it's great. It's been good, though, generally.
Well, we made it to the top. Although it's very foggy, we can't really see much. But that was a hard climb. Like we kept seeing the top and thinking it was getting, well, it just never looked like it was getting closer. We're here now and that's the last climb of the trek. Well, the last main climb of the trek. So.
The only climb I'm gonna do now is the one step it takes to get inside the shop where they sell beer near Dave's place.
We'll get there.
We spent 30 minutes or so at the top of the mountain before starting the walk down. I actually put my camera away at this point, but as we descended, we went through Bigu village and went past the nunnery there, which it's famous for.
So we've made it back, finally. I didn't actually film an awful lot on the way down because we were wanting to get down as quick as possible and I was feeling a little bit ill. But we're just relieved now. We've finished all of the climbs, finished everything, and now we're just sitting here having a beer with Jordan.
Right, it's rain.
Yeah. It's been a pretty amazing experience. And then hopefully we'll get back to Kathmandu tomorrow evening and we can just chill out and have 3-4 days of just doing pretty much nothing. So that'll be good.
The next day we had a long walk followed by a jeep journey back to Kathmandu, but this was the end of our proper trekking. At the time, the experience was certainly uncomfortable, unorganised and at times very frustrating. But looking back on it, the memories it created were really special. Being immersed in unforgiving nature and experiencing the fear of not feeling in control in a completely alien environment was such an incredible experience. There's something about this trek and my first trip to Nepal that has just begun to give me a taste of what the country has to offer. I can't wait to get back out to Nepal to really invest time into getting to know people more and to share more stories.